The Manila Hotel kicked off a special menu on Wednesday as it marked 100 years with a grand centennial ball.
Dishes infused with a sense of history are the highlight of its special gastronomic selection, available this month.
Now, Caroline Howard takes us on a nostalgic trip through hotel's history and a bite into the past.
Built along Rojas Boulevard, within a stone's throw from the Rizal Park in the walled city Intramuros, and set against the view of Manila Bay's famed sunsets, the Manila Hotel has been witness to many important events in the country's history. And this year, the hotel marks its 100th year.
This hotel was opened and inaugurated on July 4, 1912, to coincide with the declaration of American independence. And from that time on, presidents, prime ministers, foreign dignitaries, whenever they visit the Philippines, the place where they would stay would be here at the Manila Hotel. Presidents Dwight Eisenhower, President Nixon, Lyndon Johnson, President Bill Clinton, kings and queens, King of Spain, the Queen of Spain, Prince Charles. In the entertainment world, we have the likes of the Beatles, Michael Jackson.
Just how is it a testimony to the evolution of Philippine history?
Most of the political conventions of the Nacionalista, the liberal party, were all almost always held here. The 1970 Constitutional Convention, signing of international agreements in the Champagne Salon.
From 1935 to 1941, the hotel was also the official residence of General Douglas MacArthur. Dubbed the Grand Dame of Asia or Asia's premier hotel, it was designed by American architect William Parsons and later remodeled to suit the times, with its interiors a virtual testament of Filipino creativity.
And national artists were the ones who designed this, who designed most of the parts of the hotel. Leandro Locsin was the overall supervisor of the remodeling of the hotel. Look at the lobby, especially designed by a national artist. The Manila ballroom was designed by Leandro Locsin. Even the brass door of the guest elevators was designed by national artist Napoleon Bueba.
Today, the hotel remains committed to a tradition of Filipino quality service. As the hotel marks 100 years, this month it also celebrates history on the plate.
For this month, of our anniversary month, we'll have the 10th station being the historical selections from Manila Hotel. So right here we have the lapu-lapu, which is the favorite of General Douglas MacArthur. And then over there we have the chicken manhoco, which is the favorite of President Manuel L. Quezon. The chicken manhoco, manhoco actually meaning Manila Hotel Company.
And these are
both going to be on our 10th station.
Okay. Chef Christine Zarandin shows us how to prepare MacArthur's house favorite.
Today we're going to make steamed lapu-lapu wrapped in banana leaves with calamansi, beurre blanc, and some crisp maruya banana. Lapu-lapu here, and I'm going to season with a little bit of Dijon mustard. We like to use Dijon mustard because it has that white wine acidity to it. A little bit of calamansi juice and the zest and salt and pepper. So I just want to rub the whole fish. We're just gonna wrap it as if you're making suman. To seal it, I just fold the ends. And then we place it in the steamer basket. We let this sit for about half an hour to 45 minutes. And then what I'm going to do while we're waiting on that is I'm going to flavor the water with some crushed lemongrass, bay leaf, garlic, tarragon, ginger, black peppercorns. We let that sit and boil for at least 15 minutes. So depending on the size of the fish, this should take about 7-8 minutes to cook. While the fish is steaming, I'm gonna go ahead and make the calamansi beurre blanc. I'm gonna add some, just a little bit of olive oil and some butter. I'll add some shallot and my white wine. So I'm gonna let this sit and reduce for a moment. I'm adding some mustard and some calamansi juice. I'm gonna turn off the heat and then gradually, or you know, a little bit at a time, I'm gonna add the butter so you don't break the sauce. I'll add a little bit of salt and pepper. Then I have some chopped tarragon and chopped chives. Okay, so now we're gonna make the side dish, which is the, you know, the maruya that we use for merienda at home. The batter is just a little bit of rice flour, all-purpose flour, a little bit of sugar, and then seasoned with salt and pepper and some black sesame seeds.
Then Chef Christine makes a side dish.
Just buttered vegetables, of sauteed baby carrots, and some French beans.
With the fish done, it's time for plating, beginning with a bed of lemongrass rice.
So it's plain steam and just with a scent of lemongrass.
The steamed lapu-lapu goes on top of the rice and is paired with buttered vegetables and the banana fritters and glazed with the calamansi-infused sauce.
So Chef, take us through what we have here. The lapu-lapu is quite common in Manila, but you know, back then at the time of MacArthur, it's, you know, it's an expensive fish. It's a nice, thick, white fish. The flavors are quite subtle. So the calamansi actually adds character to the flavors of the fish.
So Chef, here pretty much what we're getting is a cross between Filipino and French flavors.
Yes, you know, certain things remind you of actually home cooking. I think that's what it is, but you know, we've managed to make it a little bit more sophisticated. So probably the reason also why MacArthur likes it is because he doesn't get this back home. Back home in the United States, lapu-lapu or calamansi. And the banana leaf part.
We also get to taste President Quezon's chicken manhoco.
So this is the chicken manhoco. Inside it's a stuffing of black and green olives and wild rice. Okay. And the chicken is like, you know, as we call it, it's an open canvas for the cooks. You can flavor it with anything you like. You'll find the wild rice is a bit earthy, so the chicken is able to manage that flavor. It balances it off. The olives are a bit on the sour, tart side. And then the sauce is sweet. It's made with Marsala wine, which is a fortified wine. So it kind of, you know, we find it blends very well all together. Through the years, we have to make the dishes a bit more trendy, more suiting to our palate.
But here, it's largely Spanish influenced too.
Yes, this one is very Spanish influenced. You know, Quezon has a lot of Spanish blood. So I guess that's why he preferred this dish over anything else in our menu.
It's robust and it's savory.
This culinary introduction literally takes us back decades on an interesting and enlightening bite into the past.
Well, congratulations on making history.
Thank you.
Definitely worth coming back for seconds. And that will do it for this edition of Taste Buds. I'm Caroline Howard. Remember, life's a treat. Till next time.